Y254. Imagine.
Welcome back. This is Y254 News, and today being Business Tuesday, you know, we are asking you if you have ever borrowed from the digital lending apps or the mobile lending apps, and do you know the risk involved? And tonight we have amazing guests who will be helping me discuss this issue, and you can send in your feedback using our social media platform, that is Y254 channel across all social media platform. The hashtag to use is Y254 updates. Guys, thank you so much for coming to the studio today. Yes, yes. And we have Tabitha, who is the financial expert. Yes, and we have Eddie. Hey, Mavijana.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm representing the Youth Council.
He's here to represent the Mavijana. Yeah? Yes. And you know, with the these digital lending apps, we have over 47 of them. Yeah.
Yes.
So accessing money is very easy. Just tap of your mobile phone like this, and you have like 2K to sort you out to go betting. Hey?
Sure.
And the questions we are asking tonight, why do so many youths find themselves in such a spending spree, in order for which makes them push them to borrow this money? Yeah, to Kianza na we Eddie, let's start with you.
Well, that would depend with a lot of things. If I'm to speak correctly, I would say it would depend with the life situation that the person is living at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
We youth borrow for different reasons. There are the smart reasons, and then there are useless and nonsense reasons like drinking and gambling.
Mm-hmm.
And there are smart reasons like starting a business.
Mm.
So we all borrow, but we all borrow for a purpose. I would say what would push someone to borrow, it would be his current needs at that moment.
But you know, according to statistics, most of the youths who are unemployed borrow for self-gratification. Kujibamba tu kwenda kubet, you know, pleasing your friends.
Yes, that's something I would actually accept. It is there are those who are doing that.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, to say that like all youths are doing that, it would be really wrong. And to defend the youth, since I'm here to represent the youth, I would say that there are those who borrow for the right reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Some just want to start a business and just make something out of their lives. Some want to support someone. Some do it for medical reasons. You know, there are different reasons why someone would borrow money. And for us youths, yes, we've been hindered with that idea of borrowing to go and drink, because most youths are unemployed. So that's like the easiest source of money.
And most of them being students, by the way.
AKA.
Tabitha, I don't know what your thoughts are.
Well, I'm just amused as I listen to him, because I agree with you. Most of them are taking these loans for maybe somewhat smart reasons, but sometimes you can think through these smart reasons and you probably don't need to take a loan. For example, when you say a student needs to take a loan for whatever reason, the question then would be, and how will they repay? Because every loan has to be taken smartly so that you can be able to repay. And now this digital lending and borrowing is making it very easy, because nobody knows you, nobody knows your house, so they can easily take these loans, and it comes at a cost. It really comes at a cost. So I feel like the youth are feeling they have the freedom, they have the opportunity easily given to them, but they are not looking at the cost, the implication, and whatever comes after that.
And do you think maybe this issue of youth unemployment is the main reason why our youths are on spending and borrowing spree?
Well, I would not say it is the main reason, but it is part of the reason. Because you see, if I have gone to school, or even if I have not gone to school, but I have an idea, I would need capital. Now, for us to raise capital, there has to be some form of way of raising that capital. For example, if you're employed, you can be able to save and do that. Now, with the high rate of unemployment, it leaves a majority of them, you know, with nothing else to do. However, I still think there are other ways that we can go about this and achieve the same goal without the craze that is money lending apps. And I'll tell you why I think like that. Because you see, what we have right now, the situation we have right now, Miriam, is that we have, you can borrow from more than one app. In fact, you borrow
and you pay
from app one, then you borrow from app two to pay app one. Then you realize you're in a fix with all this, and you borrow from app three to get to app two to app one, yeah? Which traditionally how borrowing and lending was happening, it was not really entertaining that. But now because it is freely there, easily gotten. So unemployment is one of them. But I also think we have reached a point where there is instant gratification that we are after. So much more than unemployment, it is that I like your dress. Or we have a road trip as girls. And I'm not going to be the one to miss out. So what do I do? I'm only 3,000 less. So what do I do?
Borrow.
So unemployment had nothing to do with it. It is instant gratification at that point that was the problem. So a few things I have to be looked up after. However, I do agree with you that to some extent, unemployment is a reason for it. Yeah.
I would also feel like, just like many other things that are in Kenya, we were introduced to these things without proper education, you know. There was no proper background of raising us to actually know what to do when we find ourselves in this situation. So most youths are actually borrowing and they do not know the ramifications. They don't understand anything. What they only know is, this is money, I need it, and it's here. Let me just get it. So blaming it all on unemployment would be unfair.
Yeah.
There's also lack of education. Yes, we go to school and we learn a lot of things, but we do not learn anything about lending money in Bosnia.
So there's no education on financial management
exactly.
to most youths.
And on top of that, the terms and conditions are too flexible. That actually makes it easier. Not that most of them read it. Most youths never read it.
And you're not reading those. read those terms and conditions.
No, some of them are flexible when you look at them. That's why like she says, it's easier for us to actually go to a lending app and borrow money. Unlike before the terms and conditions were way difficult and it would make it harder for us to go and borrow money. But right now they're flexible, you're being given a month, and after that month they can give you an extension period. You know, things like those, just, you know, these ideas not funny, I feel like, let me just borrow it today. I know I'll make it.
Yes, and do you think these easy access of loans, does it have any impact to our economy and our society right now?
I believe it. I believe there's a huge, huge impact. Now, some statistics show that over 6.5 million Kenyans are on digital borrowing apps.
Yes.
About 3 million of the, about 2 million or 1 million of them have defaulted, so they are actually listed with the CRB. This means this company is actually going at a loss. Now, for these companies to be there in the first place, they need capital. So someone pumped money into this borrowing institution, so to speak, and they are, to some extent, they are gambling. It's a gamble. I give you a loan. If you don't pay and you change your line, who pays for that loan? So it has a trickle effect if you look at it. And well, I think for them it's a gamble, because some will pay, some will not. Yeah, so it's a gamble, and eventually it will still affect the economy. Also, when the young people, the ones that are actually active right now, do not have what he said, financial literacy skills, at the end of the day it has a huge impact on the economy, because then we will have a generation of a group of people that is borrowing. There is nothing to show for the borrowing. So in the end, a lot of things happen. They stop borrowing. They do not have projects that run to the very end. And these projects need to run to the very end for the economy to continue sustaining itself. So there is a very huge impact. So I think one of the things that needs to happen is that financial literacy skills need to be imparted to everyone. And we have to take it very seriously, given the situation we are in. Schools, institutions, churches, and all that, any kind of institution should take it very seriously, that they need to pass this kind of information to people so that they know the pros and cons, because it affects all of us, whether we are borrowing or not.
Yes. Should that be the financial literacy? Can it begin from as early as primary, all the way to university?
If there was a better structure that could actually accommodate that, then yes, why not? But then again, when you think about it, it's bigger than that. It's just going and telling a kid, person afa kuomba hivi na afa kulipa hivi. You know, it has to go deep in the brain, and he has to understand, like, there's more to it than just paying it back. There's the responsibility part of it. You know, you have to understand who you are even when you're borrowing the money. It's not just a matter of going to the app and borrowing money. kitambo mwanafunzi alikuwa anamaliza shule and all he had was student loans. Now you finish school and it's more than just student loans. Kuna student loans, unadaiwa na mshwari, huko unadaiwa na fuliza, huko sijui unadaiwa na nini. And all those, they contribute to the character of the person that you become eventually, because that's how you grow and that's how you'll be. Even ukiendelea mbele, hata ukianza kupata mshahara 60,000, this is how you'll be. You'll just be borrowing me money and using your salary to just replace that money that you've borrowed.
It's
and
like then, a culture.
Hakuna kitu na, you'll habits. Never grow.
And you always live on debt.
Yeah, you'll always live on debt. On debt. Mm-hmm. So it builds the kind of person you become. So it's not just borrowing money and paying it back.
Mm.
It also has to influence, you have to also look at the part that, how does it influence a person? How does it build you as a man or as a woman?
Speaking of peer pressure and, you know, influence, mm-hmm. you want to fit in, maybe you can just tell the youths, yeah? Instead of following the peer pressure, instead of being led by the peer pressure, what is the other way you can do just to fit in, or can just be yourself?
With regards to borrowing and so money in that regard, I would say that it is first important that everyone accepts their situation the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
That at this point, Tabi is at this point.
True.
And so I can't expect to be at point D when I'm really at point A. So one of the things is to accept where you are. Number two is keep your ambitions, keep your goals, but now have a strategy. Have a strategy of how to get to where you want to be. Because if I want to be at point B, C, D, it means I need to move from point A to point B, C, and then to get to D. So it means if I need to fund a business, that I need a huge capital. What can I do? I can start with the small businesses that I can. Maybe sell, cook something and sell, buy clothes and sell.
Mm-hmm.
You can always do something that is within your means rather than skipping it all to get there. We also need to remember that there's a lot to learn in the process rather than skipping all the way to where you want. You cannot get to the ends before going through the small. And so once you accept and then you have a strategy, now keep working on the strategy, keep working on the plan, have a plan. It's also the same thing I say about borrowing. At some point, borrowing is good, right? But if you do not have a plan of how these amounts or figures that you want to borrow are going to be used, then borrowing becomes something else. So borrowing with a plan that you have thought through, sometimes even consulted with financial consultants, that is very good because it makes sure that when the amount comes, there is no misuse. I might be in need of a dress, but this money was not for a dress.
Yes. So as an expert, how can we manage our finances?
One of the I think one of the things is that we need to have and develop a culture of saving.
Mm-hmm.
We need to develop a culture of saving. It doesn't matter how much you're saving. If you save 10 shillings, that's okay. If that's all you can manage. Because 10 shillings in a whole year, you have 3,650.
Nice.
You can start a business. You don't have to start with 10,000. In fact, 3,650 is enough money to go to Gikomba, buy something, sell.
Mm-hmm.
I have bought shirts at 10, 20 shillings. Sell them at 50, the profit is 30, and I know probably if I was wiser, I would have sold them at 100.
Exactly.
Yeah. So one of the things is save.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, have a plan.
Mm.
Have a plan, stick to the plan. If you're going to deviate a little bit from the plan, make sure it's something that is well thought through. So if you have a plan, make your plan a smart plan, whereby you know this plan, I need 3-4 years to achieve it. And so I need to, step one is this, step two is this. Consult. Nobody can be able to do these things by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think as youth, sometimes we are guilty of thinking we can do it all by ourselves. I just think somehow, business yake you work, I just take it and I can actually do it better than them.
Mm.
So once you're saving,
mm-hmm.
you have a plan. Now when you're starting to execute your plan, be very careful. First know that there's a chance this can work or not. So that you don't keep taking more loans to boost a business that is already dying.
Okay.
Because that's sometimes the reason why even we, you probably had the funds to start the business, but when it started going down, you're like, I knew this was gonna work.
I need another loan.
Eddie, give me a loan. Miriam, give me a loan. When all of you fail, I need a Tala app. I just need all that. So keep working on that, yeah? And it's good to keep reevaluating your goals, keep reevaluating your progress. And as much as possible, keep reading. Have the skill that you need and perfect your skill. Then have more than one thing that you can do. All of us get a
side hustle.
Well, these days we call them side hustles. But some of the things that you can do don't really require money to start. For example, if you say can sing, you can just start by presenting yourself where people can allow you to sing in public gatherings and all that. And with time, you're called to sing at weddings, at functions.
But I think that's one of the problems with the youths today. In, like you said, respect your financial life. Mm-hmm. Now, when a youth wants to start something, they don't want to start small. They just want to start big, like, as simple as even starting a movie show. Mm-hmm. He wants to have everything, like even the flat screen there, you know. And all you need is just a computer and CDs, and voila, you can start the business. But when you don't attack too more than that, and it's you tend not to actually blame them, because in all respect, they were guide. Like, no one really guided them to actually teach them a lot. All you're like, I need this, and person you need iko hapa kwa app, so sini download tu app na niko na wifi free kwa nyumba ama kwa shule. Voila, and that's all it cost me.
And what makes youths forget their budget? You've already planned you're going to spend this amount maybe on opening day to furnish maybe your hostel. Then all of a sudden, your budget in a rise too, because you've seen somewhere, you've seen something so good. Now you want
again,
to fit in.
Again, peer pressure. Mm. Just like she says, you go somewhere and I'm a shirt in and fraisha, atami atake shirt, or it's the trending thing. Nuggets. And I have to have one. Like, I mean, unengia maali and you have to impress, and that's the only thing that can impress, and you have to have it. So once you start, like me, I agree with one thing. Respect your financial aim and have a plan.
And also
plan, siku gamble. So, you know, like I used to have a friend who used to borrow money, and then kwa hiyo pesa angetoa 500 anasema angetumia 100 kila siku ku gamble, and anakushua by the time 100 ya mwisho inagonga angekuwa alishapata ile pesa yenye alikuwa ame borrow from the beginning, analipa hiyo deni, and after again, so that's
what if doubling doesn't work, what do you do?
And he was so certain that on the last by the time anafika kwa the last 100 kwa hiyo 500 atakuwa shapata hiyo pesa imerudi. And he was so sure of it, like you'd never.
So you keep on borrowing to gamble.
He would use maybe I may borrow 3,000 shillings. He would remove 500 shillings. Now 500 shillings, he would bet with 100 shillings. That's 5 bets, and out of those 5 bets, he would get the 3,000 shillings back and pay back the loan.
Disclaimer: we are not encouraging any youths. We're not encouraging any youths to gamble.
Again, that's why I'm saying gambling is not a plan.
It's not a plan at all.
It's actually the worst thing from a plan. It's like the, I would say, opposite of a plan. Like it's the downfall of every plan, because gambling is gambling. Like there's no assurances, there's no guarantees. Once you put your money on stake, that's it. It can go na ineza rudi ama sa zingine inezaenda na iende.
And largely inaenda na inaenda. Largely it goes and goes.
True. Otherwise gambling companies ingekuwa zimefunga zote kama kila mtangekuwa anapata pesa yake back.
Let me bring in some point you said earlier. The risk involved in these lending apps.
True.
I know most people don't read terms and conditions. Because these apps, you know, they access your data. They know the people you're talking to, the ones you're texting, the pictures you take, and everywhere you go, even your location, it knows. So do most youth know the risk involved?
You know, a while back, like 2 days ago, I was passing by somewhere, and I had these two guys speaking, and they were saying, the reason why they introduced Fuliza was because the terms and conditions in Mshwari did not allow the Safaricom people to take their money back as they would love to, okay? And me, I was like, so against that. Then I wanted to educate, but then again, my little was in the computer. Now, one thing is, most of them do not understand the terms and conditions, because no one ever reads the terms and conditions. Very few people read the terms and conditions. Ata wenye wanaingiaga, wanaingiaga kwanza. And then baadaye, later on, is when they go to the computer and then they start, or they go to online and then Google the terms and conditions, but most people don't read it. And that's where the most betting companies and money lending apps, they gain that advantage, because they know you do not know the terms and conditions. And you don't care, because hizo shida zako are bigger than the terms and conditions. Unadaiwa rent, ulipatia msichana wenyewe mimba. These are just problems of the youth. Pesa inatakikana, and you have to go and nini.
Let's hear from a financial expert. do the youth know, and what is the importance of us knowing these terms and conditions?
Again, I'll give you some statistics. I told you about 6.5 million Kenyans are on digital borrowing, digital borrowers, so to speak. About 3.3 million of them do not know the interest rates that they are paying.
Interest rates.
They do not know. That means there was an opportunity to take money, so I took the opportunity. Now, it is very important to read the terms and conditions, because one of the things that really drives me to be against this digital borrowing and all this is that we are selling our future. We are selling our future because as we said, we are living on debts. Mm-hmm. That means that today, we are in April. We're in April, by the time I'm getting my salary for end of April, it's supposed to take me through May.
Mm-hmm.
But it's paying my debts for April. And when you have this continuous cycle, it continues and it continues such that the year is 2020, you're paying debts for 2019. Mm-hmm. You will never grow. Mm-hmm. Secondly, exactly. It is that we are doing it right now because we are young, we feel we have the energy, somehow we can maneuver, we can manage. But once you're listed at CRB, when you have a proper plan and a proper business that really indeed requires a good financial backup, you will go to a proper lending institution, say a bank or a SACO or something, and right there in the middle of your success plan, you'll realize you sold your future a long time ago. A long time ago, when you were young
and naive
because you did not read the terms and conditions, but somehow you had the knowledge to download the app. So it is that we sell our future to the apps.
Mm-hmm.
And we do not know that it will eat us up 3, 4, 5 years from now. So.
Okay, you spoke about interest rates.
Yes,
eh?
Yes.
The banking sector was the other day they were complaining about these crazy interest rates.
Yes.
So do you think these lending apps should be regulated, and who will regulate them?
I definitely believe and I think that they should be regulated. In fact, even the banks themselves are asking that the government regulates. And this is the argument which I am for. If we are going to regulate we are going to cap the interest rates for banks and such, for the banks, based on what CBK is giving, why then isn't it cutting across all lending apps?
Exactly.
Why is it being used sparingly?
Exactly.
That banks are capped. Mobile or digital lending apps are not capped.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, I really think that they should be capped. The other day, the members of parliament asked the CBK to find a way of regulating this. Because it is important. We need to take care of our future. We need to take care of our youth. And one of the ways to do that, if they're not going to do it themselves, at least the government should do it for them by coming up with regulations that are going to ensure that even if we are going to... Because you see, we cannot control everyone.
Yeah.
But at least there should be ways of regulating everything so that we are all under the same umbrella as given by the CBK. So I think the CBK... Should regulate these mobile lending apps.
Okay, and finally, because you're out of time, Eddie.
Yes.
Do you think the digital, this digital era is affecting the youths in terms of borrowing and lending?
Yes, I do. I actually do believe that it's really affecting the youth because it's actually making one to become mentally lazy. Like seriously. Before when you had a problem and you had to find money, the first thing you think of is a job.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Or going to work for someone, something that hard labor. Yeah.
You work for it.
I remember, like, when I finished high school, I used to, like, go and clean windows. I used to work for a window cleaning company.
Mm-hmm.
And I would go and clean windows from 8 to 2. And I would risk my life because the areas I was climbing were so high. And then there were no insurances, there was nothing. And I would go and I would climb windows and I would wash you. And at the end of the day, they would pay me. And I would get paid 4,500 shillings at the end of the month. Okay?
Nice,
it was petty money, but I needed it and I used and I went for it. Mm-hmm. Okay? But you see right now, when I need something as small as 4,500 shillings, I don't have to go and work for a whole month. All I have to do is just sit down.
Tap your phone.
They're borrowing 200. They're borrowing 200.
Yeah.
So you see, I think it has really affected us as we grow because we're not growing as like mahasla wa kitambo, the way our parents would have wanted us, like the way they grew up. We do not grow up with a very different mentality, with a very different idea of hustling, with a very different idea of becoming the provider because. Some would just sit in the house and just wait for that to come.
They repay this loan using their parents' money.
Exactly.
Parents don't know what they're doing.
they're paying
people's loans.
Yeah.
Enough for Najua. One would call his parent and say, "Hey, mom, I need like 2,000 shillings." And my mom can be, "Hey, Mr. Isina, 2,000 shillings, you'd have to wait until the end of the month." Thank you for that. Until the end of the month. Fuliza, nipe 2,000 shilingi. Mama amesema atanipa the end of the month. As simple as that.
Well, tell me your final comments.
Well, I would say this. It is first good to create and cultivate a culture of borrowing, of saving. A culture of saving. And number two, I'll say that before borrowing, it is good to have a plan. They say chance favors a prepared mind. In the same way, when you have an opportunity to get money, whether through borrowing or just somehow umeangukia, just have a plan. Always have a plan. It makes life easier when the money comes.
Yes.
But when there's no plan, even if you have the money, it's how we have millionaires today and two tomorrow. Years later they are borrowing.
Well, always have a plan, according to Tabitha, who is a financial expert. And you also had Eddie, who was representing Mavijana kwa studio. Well, that's the time we'll all add here. My name is Miriam Masava. Until next time, good evening and good night, and God bless you. Goodbye.